Before we go to work, we gotta get rid of some mice. Are you ready?
Let's drain all the little holes.
Oh, there goes one.
Yeah. Ah, you missed it.
Did you jump out?
Yeah, I think so.
I'm trying to shake the mice out.
They just keep dropping stuff off here. There's supposed to be a storage trailer coming. It's been coming since October.
Yep.
And all these skins are going to go in there until camp. Well, I think camp's coming before the storage trailer.
Nice. All right, splitting the tractor and replacing some bushings. Here we go.
All right, well, we're back on the Steiger. And the transmission works great.
Perfect.
The brakes work like they've never worked before.
Nice.
It stops. But if you watch the video when we put the transmission in, and then you saw we put the transmission in, and then it went like this, I went clunk. Oh, crack,
we got a little gap in the pivot pins.
All right, we're good. Because these were wore out. So I knew this, that, and I thought that one was pretty much wore out. This is just a bushing and a pin. And this one down here is like this big, like it's a uniball, it's a spherical bearing. So it goes all different directions.
Okay.
But then over, something must have went wrong because you can see all the retaining ring here. And the bolts are broken and you see that whole bearing is coming out now. I'm hoping that the hole that goes in is still okay. Like if that's just the, I'm thinking this is round, but that's the bearing and the flange is still in there.
Okay.
I don't know, we're gonna find out, but we gotta split it.
Nice.
But seeing how I'm so intelligent, I managed to put some poor man's air conditioning in. Someone online had said, oh, normally they bust the windows out of the cab before they fix those. And I'm like, man, it's so far away. Like when you turn the tractor, there was like a good like this far distance, right? But then we got into some really rough ground last fall. And when you turn the tractor and it goes like this, like the pivot, and it's turned, then this corner here just touches the window.
Just a little bit.
Enough to punch it up. And because I'm so super smart, I managed to knock both windows out before I figured it out.
Yeah, so
that was a field fix one day. The bolt was broken, but everything seemed to be fine.
Okay.
So we just welded that in there and we keep rolling.
And now you have to unweld it?
So now we have to unweld it. I knew that at the time because nobody had the big bolt. Like it's a big, huge bolt. Nobody had it.
Yep.
So it's like, okay, we got to get core in the ground. So we'll just weld it up for now. That was a couple of years ago. That was long before this broke. But then I was jacking it up to get things lined up. And this one seemed tight. It was this one that had all the play in it.
Okay.
So that's just a bushing. I didn't think that's not too bad. And then there's another one of these fancy things. Like this is a big link on the backside right here. Right. Fancy. Oh, okay. So that one doesn't look too bad, but I'm buying the kit. It's gonna come with, from Big Tractor Parts, you buy the kit and it comes with everything you need. So you buy the kit for the top link, it comes with that pin and that bushing, and it comes with the front bushing and the pin. And then you buy, you know, there's another kit that comes with like everything you need here. Cause there's another one of these spherical bearings in the drawbar. So everything to fix that. And then there's another kit, which is the most bang for your buck, to fix the steering pins.
Yep.
So there's one front and back. So we're gonna do, we might as well do them all now that we have it working so great with the transmission and all. So we're gonna split it. So depending on how you do it, so this here could be another right way or better way. The way the book wants you to do it is you hold this all up and then you unhook everything and you just push it apart. But what we're gonna do is take the drive shaft off, take the fuel lines off, we'll use a little vacuum cleaner trick again. And then this is an online, I didn't think of this myself. You take one of the cylinders and you switch the hoses. And then you, because the tractor will still run.
Yeah.
Right? And then these hoses here, instead of unhooking them all, we're just gonna unbolt the couplers off of here and then slide them in. It'll give us enough slack.
Okay.
To pull it apart. And then you just start the tractor up. Because everything is up there and you just turn the steering wheel, and because you have, like, normally when you turn the wheel, one cylinder is pushing and one's pulling.
Yep.
If you flip the one around, they'll both push.
Yep.
And then you just push it apart.
Oh, nice.
Until you have it far enough to do your thing. And then when you want to put it back together, then you pull it back together.
Nice. You have a stand to roll it?
So I have I got my,
cause I have one.
I have my stand here.
Oh, you got your crane?
Yeah, perfect crane. So I don't know, we might have to sweep the floor here first.
It's the Canadian humor that it's not this much dirt on a concrete floor. You can sweep till you're blue in the face, but you're not going to find concrete.
No. Stay tuned. Put the tracks down, and then we'll put that in the back. The back is, all depending on how much fuel it is if it's going to be back heavy or front heavy. But I don't have any rear weights back here. Like, there's like a bracket here. You can put rear weights here. I can't see how it would be back heavy. I'm pretty sure it's going to be
Just put a floor jack underneath the driveway. Just to tell you, no.
Right? Or something, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So, like, the front is going to be, I think, back heavy. We'll put the jacks here, but I am going to crib up the front.
Yeah.
Because we don't need... You know, we don't need things going south.
We'll make a better video.
All right, so we did finish with the nice air conditioning, so we're gonna have to vacuum all those acres out of the cab.
Yeah.
That's where we're at. So
nice.
We're gonna get going on this.
All right, here we go.
Okay, so getting things apart. I thought I'd take the bolt out of this pin and top came off. So this little tab is supposed to keep that top pin from spinning so it spins in the bushing and not in the housing. And the fact that it's broken is usually an indicator that it seized in the bushing and now spinning in the housing. We just hope that it hasn't spun too much and worn the housing out. Like looking at the weld where it's broke on both, it looks pretty fresh, so I don't think that's been rubbing for too long. It's possible that it's just kind of, when the bottom one went, that it kind of like pinched that bushing, went like this, and grabbed that pin so it couldn't turn, and that's what broke it. So that's what we're hoping. So I got it jacked up down here just to take the play out of it, and then we're gonna see if that pin actually moves. I'm just give her a few whacks here with the swinging press. Okay, well, looks like it's gonna move. So that's good news. Now the next project is we wanna get our stand under the back, but this drawbar is in the way. And this drawbar is on the same pin that holds the pivot. So there's a bushing in here, and then there's another one in the drawbar up in here. So I'm gonna attempt to get this nut off and then see if we can drive that pin up. The problem being, I can already see the threads right here are kind of munched. Probably gonna do a little grinding here. I don't wanna get the nut off, otherwise we'll just cut it off because, well, as we know, that bolt's already junk, and then hopefully we can use a press, or a jack, sorry, jack that up far enough, get this drawbar out of our way so we can get our stand in there. So that's the plan. Here we go. Okay, I got a little bit sick of trying to get that nut off. So we cut it in half. I got the front end cribbed up just to take some of the pressure off. I got the jack under the pin, and now we are gonna see if it's gonna move. Okay, so it's picking the whole tractor up. It is moving here, up and down a little bit. But I don't think it's moving down here. We have to cut the bolt off top and bottom here, get this out, and then cut it off and pound it out in pieces. Well, I beat on it with a sledgehammer underneath and it's moved. But now, of course, I got the bottom mushroomed. We're gonna soak this with WD-40, pound it down, pound it up, pound it down, pound it up, pound it down, until we get it kind of sliding, and then we'll grind the mushroom off and see if we can punch it up.
That worked. Once we got it moving a little bit, and then Jack pushed it right out. We got the drawbar laying there, and that bushing looks like it doesn't move anymore. So now we'll drag this big heavy thing out that way, probably use a forklift, and then we can get set up to split it.
Yeah, we're not gonna break our arm?
That's the plan, is not break our arms.
Sorry, leg arm. Don't break my arm. There we go. I got it. That's heavy. Dad's got a lip on it.
Yeah, so either we...
Whether you take these bolts out or...
Take these bolts out or we just leave it there.
I think we just leave it there.
Other than it's going to put a little bit more weight on the back. That should be fine. Hopefully we can pound this bushing out sitting. That's probably actually not a bad spot to get that bushing out of there. So, yeah, this is supposed to spin.
Oh, okay.
And it doesn't. And the bottom will bust it out of it.
Yeah, you're gonna leave the fuel lines. Just take that one little.
Try that. And then,
there's a little bit of play here. We might be able to.
Yeah.
I think you'll be all right.
Take this off and then maybe reach in there. And...
Oh, they are bolted there though. That bolt could come out.
Because your tank is full.
No. It's quite empty, actually.
Yes. It's always deceiving when you tap it, but you're still on top of this?
I'm probably about to.
Okay. You got a cap for it?
Yeah, right over there from when we left it last winter.
Okay. Sounds good.
Why don't we get some stands underneath it and
okay.
See how we feel.
Sounds good.
And hopefully it doesn't derail like Ohio.
Yeah. Should be all right.
Maybe I should put that... block on the top.
Okay, so we got a nice little Princess Auto Jack, 20 years old.
Yeah, how old's your Jack?
20 years old.
Not 20 years old?
I don't know where I got it from though.
Same place that it was made, both of them, I guarantee it.
Yeah, China.
Yeah, we'll jack up on the back, jack up on the front. We think that the front is heavy. Because the axle's pretty far back. Fuel tank is in front, and it's...
Yeah, the front is definitely heavy at the back.
Yeah, and then he's got the pin out, and then one more pin up the front, left the fuel lines alone, and hopefully we have enough to spread it open.
Still relatively tight in this hole?
Oh yeah, okay. That's... Now the engine is in front of the front axle, but the entire transmission is behind the back axle plus the cab. So it shouldn't be front heavy. It's definitely back heavy. We're pretty sure.
So now what? So now we're gonna try and turn the wheels and push it apart.
Because you flip the hoses on one side.
On this side.
Okay.
So the park and brake is on the front drive axle.
Okay.
So that should keep the front end from moving. And hopefully the backside just kind of nicely goes backwards, just a little bit.
Nice.
If I go really fast, then it's going to be
yeah, fast. Just a little bit. That's good. All right.
Make sure you open a window so we can talk to each other.
Yeah.
Starter. Back after 20 minutes?
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah.
Okay, this rear bushing here, which is worn out, is stuck. The pin is stuck in there. We cut the top off. We tried to make this nice bridge on top here. Tried hammering it down to pound that pin down that was moving. I thought it was stuck in this bushing up here. But it's actually stuck in this bearing here. I tried to make a thing to push it up from the bottom. Tried to push from the top. It moves up and down in the holes here and here. Won't move in here. So, seeing how that's a part that's gonna be replaced, we are just going to use this. We got the fire brigade, just in case things go south. I did clean up all my penetrating oil I had kicking around, so hopefully nothing starts on fire. Yeah, here we go. We got it torched off top and bottom. It was a little bit of a fight because A, I was quite nervous because right on top, right here, is the fuel tank. So now we're gonna pull that big beam out the top. I'm gonna rig up something here to kind of hold this up. So once I slide it back a couple inches, this drops, it doesn't bind. And then see if we can slide it back. I don't know if I'm gonna pull this right out or just pull it out far enough to change the bushings. I have a feeling I'm gonna have to pull it right out to get the bushings out, but yeah, you never know. Maybe we'll get lucky. So that is actually coming out. It's over halfway out, so that wasn't too bad, just banging it at the bottom. So that one will come out the way it sits, as long as we can get those bushings out of here. I think there's enough room in there to get it out. I will just slide it ahead, so just on there. So if we can get this other bushing out, sitting here, get this seal out, we'll see if we can drive that thing down. I am not overly confident, but you don't know until you try. That thing is in there really, really tight. I'm thinking it's coming out with the torch anyways. So if we get the back apart, we'll torch this one out. So if we get the back out, we'll just leave that sit there right there. Out. Yeah. All right, man, as you get the top one out, which means there should be room for the bottom one. Let's see if we can torch that bushing out the front. And away we go. Actually, we can probably just slide this forward and then work through this hole to get the bottom one out. Hey, that's a good idea. Oh yeah, I love it. Just like that. So I didn't cut it out. I just put some heat on the inside. That kind of like, if you heat it, it's trying to swell. The outside is still cool. And then when it cools off, it shrinks a tiny bit and now it's moving. So now I can drive that out. That's how I'd take a lot of bearing cups out of the inside of transmissions too, because you don't want to cut it because it'll blow slag all through your transmission. You just heat it up hot and it can't expand because of the casting, and then that section you heat up hot gets soft, and when that section gets soft, then that's where it shrinks, just enough that it'll fall out. So there's little bushings where the pin goes through. That's the nice thing about this. Even if your pin gets loose here and gets working in your housing, there is replaceable bushings top and bottom, so you don't need a machine shop to fix your housing. Those are just replaceable bushings, so they are really stuck in there. So I'm going to give them the same trick with the torch, just heat them up and then they should dry out. So ideally that should come right out of there now. Oh, look at that. I think it just falls out now. All right, so top bushing out, bottom bushing out. There's a washer welded on the top, and there was one welded on the bottom as well. So of course that got knocked off and we knocked the bushing out. I don't know why they're supposed to hold the bushing in there. Is that something somebody put on there because they're having trouble with loose bushings, or is that a factory thing? But the bushing can't come out through the washer, so one of them's got to get knocked off. So I'll put a bushing in there and we'll tack that washer back on there later, I guess. Strange. To get these out, just did the heat them up. We used to have trouble with like bearing cups stuck in the transmissions.
Yep.
And then you can't get them out, and it's a blind hole. And then if you torch them out, right, you make a big mess. Or if you weld them, you got slag flying as a transmission. But I would just put a brazing tip on and then just heat it up until it gets red hot and then let it cool. And then you pretty much just right out.
Nice.
Yeah. So that worked good.
I learned something new every day.
Yeah. And then, so the new ones, I think I'm going to toss them in the freezer. And then hopefully they'll drop in. And then this bar here, you're supposed to like take it all the way out and knock the bushings out, but it's really big and heavy. So I managed to get the bushings out sitting in there. What's this whole thing? I just thought it was like, this was a bushing in here.
Oh.
Right? And then there was a seal in there, right? Yep. And then so I heated it up, thinking that's gonna drive out, and then the whole thing came out. And then I went and said, well, what the heck? And I went and got the new one, and oh, look, the new one's that big too. So.
I run into that too, where you don't look at your new parts before you start taking the old stuff apart.
It's like, oh, okay, well, that's all cool. So I don't know, like, that's pretty intense how wore out it's got to be. But you can see, well, you can't really see now, but you could see there was some on the one side was worn. I put the pin in there. Where'd the old pin go? I don't know, but it was worn.
Okay.
So this just that main bushing now, we gotta just split it apart to do that main one.
Yep.
Right?
And I'm just gonna, we got new batteries, which is your annual routine.
Yeah, like, semi-annual.
Let's go all electric because we've figured out lead acid batteries so magnificently that they last all of 24 months. All right, fire it up and roll her back.
Yeah. All right, you're gonna watch it?
I'll watch it. I'll make sure the stuff's happening and stuff, your hoses don't get too tight, but that's the extent of my helping. That's pretty good. There you go, then you got left. Roller's moving. So you're clear now. But you can go a bit farther if you want to. Doesn't
want to
quit.
That's how it wants to go to work.
We're all about farm safety here.
Don't worry, that'll be bolted back up before we get to the field. Well, there we go. Well, that's easy.
That was pretty slick.
Yeah. The internet is pretty smart some days.
Yeah.
So, yeah, this is shot.
You already took the bolts out?
No, they're broken.
Oh, okay.
I got some work ahead of me. I got to draw all those suckers out.
Okay, so what I learned from the internet is take a washer and weld the washer on it and then weld a nut to it. And I've tried it. Works way better than just a nut.
Oh, this might be, Chiba might be getting the call here.
Yeah. Nice. All right.
Have a look at this. There's still a piece of the old one in there.
Yeah. If there's a piece of the old one still stuck in there, that means it wasn't moving.
Well, yeah, the bottom part, right? The top. So it's just a mat, like the top is all
broken.
Oblong.
Yeah, right. Vince can probably weld that, and then you just take a reamer. Put some Loctite on it, an old JB weld.
Yeah, that's not good.
No, that's not good at all.
All right, well, we'll get that apart, and we'll see how we get that out, get the bolts out. That's not cast, that's steel. So that's easier to weld to and work with.
Yeah.
If we gotta bore it out and put a sleeve in there.
Nice. All right, well, I'm gonna leave you to it.
All right.
Good luck.
Well, we'll clean that up. A burr in there. And then we'll see how bad it really is.
Couple more bushings, one in this top hole, one in this bottom hole. We're gonna take them out the same way, heat them up with a torch, knock them out, and that's the last two bushings out. And then we gotta figure out what we're gonna do with this hole.
This side is good. The bottom is good all the way around, but it's just this side here, which has been worn back. So there's not enough room between the bottom and the top here to get the machine shop's boring bar in. So we might build this up because it's just this back end, which is the back, I don't know, half, top half, and then just the back. So we might just build that up. I have an idea. I'm not gonna tell you what we're gonna try until we actually figure out what we're actually gonna try. So I gotta get these bolts out, drill these bolts out. These ones are all broke off all the way down. This one is, the hole is all mushed. So I don't know if we just grind this down so that we can get that hole, maybe to drill it, I don't know. But anyways, we got a little bit of creative machining to do here.
Basically, we're gonna fill the cup up with water, don't know if I need more than one cup. Oh, perfect. Kevin's gonna just build on top of that and see if he can build like a really nice, smooth, flat surface on the other side that's not porous at all. And then we'll get Vince to do it properly. So then what you do is you drill a hole in the bottom of the mug, and somebody just constantly pour new water in so that it runs out the bottom and stays cool, right? Because it did crack there, but keep going. Yeah, so it didn't stick at all, right? That's exactly what you wanted. And then the weld on the inside. Like, that's not bad.
It's not bad, a little touch for the grinder and a little grinding wheel, sand that up.
Right. It's not like it's super connecting, but we didn't clean the steel or anything either. I think that's not bad.
Well, I think that, I don't think it's going to take much to clean that up.
No. Then you're in the right shape, and then you can just kind of...
Well, the die grinder with a... I got some of those grinding.
Yeah.
We don't have to go all the way around. We just need to go, like, the back a little bit, and not even all the way to the bottom.
Right.
So then you can even use, like, something straight off the square... So you make sure that you're straight in the bottom, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, what do you think? Fail? Or
I think it's better than JB Weld or brass.
Oh, I think...
Yeah.
JB Weld just got mush out of there, I think.
Yeah.
So, but then if you can keep the heat maybe pointed in towards the... Because when I was first going, I was like literally like welding against the cup.
Right.
Right, where you don't need to point your heat at them. So you just get to point the heat at the metal. That's where you need the metal, right?
Yeah.
So is it tea, ready for tea yet or what?
No,
still cold.
Not even close, it's cold, yeah.
You think having the water is the way to go? I think so.
So that one just as planned. Top one took a few extra whacks because there's still a tiny little bit of weld holding it on the top. Once that was broke, fell right out. Bottom one came right out. So I think I'm gonna put the new bushings in the freezer and then they'll shrink a little bit, and we can tap them in there and should be good to go. We gotta finish this mess, but we're gonna go outside and torch out the bushing out of the drawbar, and then we're done with the torches. All right, so just cut the inside one out so I could get to the outside and heat that up, and then that one's out. All right, fix that hole and time to put new parts in.
Okay, now I gotta try and get these bolts out. This one's gonna be tough. Grind that one down. This one, I don't know. But these anyways, we'll try the easy ones first. Hopefully they're easy. I got this fancy kit here that comes with these sleeves if you have a hole. So just stick that in there and then that'll line up the drill bit nice and straight. So I'm gonna try that first. Try one of these or try these three out first. Hopefully this is easy. I'm not a real big fan of drilling out bolts. I've done lots. Sometimes this comes good. Sometimes it's an all day affair to get one out. Hopefully these are the good ones. Okay, here we go. Those are some long bolts. Well, we can give it the old college try here for a minute. All right, so that's just spinning inside. So this is gonna be the not easy ones.
So I just ground off the bottom and you can see the outside of a, looks like a bolt there. So those things must have been sticking through a little bit, I guess. So I guess we gotta drill a little more to get all the way through.
I thought the holes were blind, but I guess not. We got all the way through. Now we're through. Let me try this again.
I'm confused, it doesn't look very much like a bolt. Looks like it had some threads there. There's no threads here anymore. Unless they were all, yeah, I guess they were all, looking at them now, they were all studs. So maybe we can drive them all out. That'd be all right. Well, that makes life easier. I've never seen studs just shoved. Normally they're threaded into the one side, like it's a threaded hole, then you screw the stud in. And then it sticks out. But these are just, looks like pressed in. Unless there's supposed to be bolts coming up from the bottom.
That's possible too. Because they're going right through. Maybe there are bolts. I'll have to check. Maybe they're broken before and this was somebody else's fix, because the other side, which is the same bearing, has threaded holes that you stick the bolts in. So maybe I'm not the first one here, but I'm gonna investigate and find out. Well, this is a whole lot easier than drilling all bolts. That's nice. Just like that. They're all out. Well, that was it easy. Now I had nothing to do the rest of the day. I figured I was gonna be drilling bolts all day, but they just pounded out. So that was simple. Awesome.
Okay, so while we're waiting for parts, all the bushings are on order. It's a good time to go over the machine and change the oil and grease everything. So for the oil change, of course, we're using Rotella. You might be interested to know that Case, John Deere, and Cat, they don't make their own oil. They actually use whoever is the lowest bidder on a set term contract, because most of the base oils end up being the same, and then whoever can make their oil with their additives and their requirements the cheapest gets to have the contract for X amount of time. So if you want to know that you got the really good oil, just stick with T5 and T6. You know it's good stuff. It's consistent, it's the exact same, it does not change, and it's great for your engine, whether it's agriculture, your transport truck, or you're just your pickup. I know I've been using T4 for 25 years, you guys know that. And now we're actually working our way up to nicer equipment so we can start running T5 and T6. This old 9350 loves the T5. It's not fancy enough for T6 just yet, but give her the good stuff. Here we go.
Most important part of the oil change, tighten the plug.
Okay, so the age-old controversy here, Kevin, you're gonna put oil in, but I take my time and do it around the outside because then it's filtered oil. If you throw it through the middle, it's unfiltered oil. And there's some service manuals that say, do not fill your oil filter because they don't want unfiltered oil.
It's a brand new jug. It's brand new oil. When you rebuild your engine and you put oil on your bearings, on your brand new rebuilt engine, do you get it out of a brand new jug? Or do you dump it through a filter first before you put it on your bearings?
Point taken. All right, dump it in, because that's a big filter to filter the side.
So I'm looking at this going, if you don't fill the filter, you have, what, 2 liters of oil that it's got to pump through here before it starts getting to your engine?
That's my thought exactly.
Right? That's a lot of oil. So I always fill it because, especially on startup, you want the oil there.
So that depends whether it's a full flow or like a full system or partial system. So if the oil filter is right after the pump, it has to fill the pump. Sometimes it goes through the bearings first, and whatever oil is left over goes through the filter. So that's a partial filtering.
So like the old International tractors, and I never understood why they did this, is it gonna be hit against International. They mounted the filters like this.
Yeah.
So they would run empty at night. Like, why? That's the only I've ever seen. Like everybody else is all the right way, this way, open end up. We're gonna need another jug to fill this filter.
20 minutes later, quite a few jugs to fill this tractor, but we'll get there. Here we go.
Some of it's going on the outside. The trick is to get it enough so it doesn't fall off, but don't go too crazy because A, you won't get it off, and B, you'll squish the filter, right?
Yep. So you're the one taking it off, so you put it on as tight as you want.
You want to bring the forklift with the pallet of oil in so we can fill this in?
Yeah, one jug down, about 6 to go.
Okay, we're gonna put these pin bushings in. This is an old one here, just to show. I got the new ones in the freezer, so hopefully they'll go in easy. But I made myself a little press, I guess. I don't know, it's pretty simple. Just gonna put that in there, this on top, and then tighten the bolt up, and that should suck that bushing in. I think that's gonna be a little bit better than smashing them in with a hammer. With the hammer, you always could peen them over, or there's not a whole lot of room in here to work. So hopefully with the fact that they're in the freezer, they'll slide right in. At least that's the science on it. Here we go. Ah, it's gone in a crooked.
All
That is starting to get a little bit munched. Oh, we got a little bit of a lip in there now. Oops, all right, we'll clean that up and go get another one out of the freezer. Try again. All right, press idea was a fail. Yes, you just pound them in with a hammer. All right, next. So those actually went in really good. I think maybe it's because I had them in the freezer for 2 days instead of just 6 or 7 hours like I had these ones. Yeah, they went in pretty good. I got the grease fitting almost in the exact same spot as the last one. So I gotta put a seal. There's a seal that goes in here, top and bottom, to keep the dust from getting in there. And then Vince is coming to fix up our hole. You can see I had that all the way down there. You can see there's a bit of a gap on the one side. And it goes in nice and solid, but this gap on this side, I just don't trust that. That's gonna break out. So we gotta get some filler in behind there. Otherwise that does fit in there nice. So this is the old one, obviously. Yeah, so hopefully he comes this afternoon and then we can roll this thing back together. So we did the try at your place and we thought, well, we'll give it a whirl. So this one just fits perfect in the bottom, but it's a little bit tight in here. So we're gonna cut it so that then he can get in beside it, maybe build it up.
Oh, okay.
See, and then this is a little bit, it'll probably be a little, like if it welds right tight to this, it might be a little bit tight, and then we can just buff it back.
Yeah, see, I thought that you might have to like grind this just so you can get the rod down in deep, and right, then then build it up.
Well, he's gonna MIG it.
Oh, you're gonna MIG it?
So yeah, I think if we cut it, then he can do the bottom, and then we can stick to the next, and I have a spare cup.
Yeah. Okay.
They look at you funny when you're at the dollar store with a tape measure, measuring all the cups.
Yeah. You ever heard of this being done before?
I've seen it done not this way.
Not this way, but what do you usually use?
Usually you have an orbital welder and you have an orbital mill. Oh, and it's all on a system that you hook up to a spinning rod.
Like something you can pick up at Princess Auto for $300?
No, it's like a $30,000 machine.
That's why. Yeah. We're using a $3 cup. And try it, you think it'll work?
Yes.
Yeah, nice.
I think if we can build that up, if I can just get a nice little ledge of weld on there, then I can start stacking.
Okay.
And
so you're gonna like lift the cup up as you go?
Probably not.
No?
I'll probably just use the first one for the root.
Yeah.
And then I'll have my weld as a step and I can just build it right up alongside.
Oh, okay.
And
okay.
It'll be, again, we'll see how it reacts.
Okay, you know? Right then. Here we go.
Welding, it doesn't sound like that.
No, that's funny. Just a little flex core welder, right?
Yeah.
Oh, yes. Nope. No expensive welder. Nope. Just let me have it.
Smash. Nice. Smash that out of there now.
Yeah.
Oh, you know how much that thing cost me?
He left the price tag on it just so to let you know that's coming off the paycheck.
All right. Now he's got the shape. What do you think?
Yeah, nice.
Here's a strip here, just because there's no line.
You need the air now to clean up, or are you?
No, that's just air.
Just let him do his thing.
Yep.
I pounded the old bearing bushing, whatever you want to call this thing, spherical bearing, from the back in here. It's the same size. And you can see, I don't know if you can see or not, there is a tiny little bit of space. It did drive in right from the top all the way down. It's got lots of good support back here now. Vince did a great job fixing that up. So I'm gonna drive that out and then put the new ones in the freezer. And I think I'm gonna have to drill these holes out here a little bit. I took the die grinder and brought them back a little bit, but I'm just gonna run a hole through them. I'm gonna put this plate back on top.
Just make sure everything lines up and then we'll drive the new one in and bolt her in. Good to go.
Okay, the drawbar bushings. The old one looks like it's greasable. New one is greasable. But the drawbar hole has no hole in it anywhere or grease fitting on it. So that's strange. And the old one was so seized up. I thought, well, did they used to be greasable? Why would they have a greasable bushing in there? So I went back in the parts books, and in the 9150s, yeah, they had a grease fitting. They had a grease fitting right here in the front. And I don't know why they don't do that anymore. If they thought, well, it doesn't need to be greased. Well, if it doesn't need to be greased and you're not worried about it seizing up, then why make me put this really expensive spherical bearing in there when you can just put just a round bushing in? I'm thinking that I'm going to make this greasable. I'm just gonna drill a hole in here and tap it out and put a grease fitting in there, just like the old ones were. Because as the saying goes, they just don't make them like they used to, but we're gonna make it like it used to be. So here we go. Here, I got this one hammered in the drawbar. I use a center punch to kind of dimple the shaft over, or the, not the shaft, the whatever, the drawbar part over, keep that from falling. I guess that's to keep it from falling out. I don't know, the old one was dimpled in. So we did that. Grease fitting works, got it lubed up. So this one's ready to go back on. Okay, we're gonna install the new spherical bearing here. Goes all directions. So get the hole all cleaned up. So we wanna line up this hole, grease hole, with this hole. You wanna make sure you do not drive it in banging on here, this nice easy flat spot, because you'll smash it. So you gotta find something that goes on the outer ring that you can drive on. Well, it just so happens that a gear out of the transmission works perfect. So there, that's what we're gonna use to drive it in, an old transmission gear. There we go. So my big bushing driver won't fit past here, so I'm just gonna try and pull this one in with the plates on some longer bolts, and then maybe I gotta tap it around. I don't think this one's gonna go in that hard. That's what we're gonna do for this one. Okay, so we got a little small problem with the grease gun tool. We got some coming out of here where we want it to be coming out of, and we got a lot gooping out of here, which has likely got something to do with the fact that our hole is not professionally machined. So if I put a little bit of sealant on this plate, that should seal this up, and then the grease has to get into there. So that's what we're gonna do, because it fits in there really good and tight. So if that's the only problem, then we're in good shape.
So Kevin wanted to make sure that the internet knew that he's torquing these bolts to recommend the torque spec.
Yeah, because you'll just see me using the impact, and then everyone will be like, oh, he wants to torque those to, 45, by the way.
He even knows the actual torque spec. This is amazing. So Kevin didn't, I don't know. Look at that. He didn't realize it was a through bolt, but that is not bad for drilling that out and trying to pull that out. But it went a lot easier than you thought, eh?
Yeah, well, when I started hammering the easy out in, that started coming out. I'm like, what's going on? The parts book shows true bolts, but the service manual shows
threaded in bolts.
Threaded bolts. And we didn't look at this mess here, but looked at this mess, you notice that it's a nut,
yeah,
on it, right?
Yeah.
So, but this is what the bolts look like. Right, so when that's underneath, you don't really realize that it's supposed to be a bull head sticker.
Yeah, because you'd stick your finger down here, yeah, but that's all rubbed off.
It's all rubbed off, so it kind of looks like there's just broken bolts in there.
And blood. Lots of blood when you scrape your finger.
Because these ones back here, This is the same, the exact same part that goes in there, but this one's got bolts. So I just thought that was the same.
I wonder if it's an update halfway through they decided, you know what, let's just drill the holes through. Rather than...
No, it's probably like that. I'm just dumb.
Yeah, well, no, just the fact the service manual is one way and the parts manual is another, so. Nice.
Anyways.
So, ready to throw it back together?
Yeah, so let's tell you my little, you know, Vince did a great job welding that up, but of course, you don't get a finish like this, right? Unless you machine it, right, on the inside?
Yeah.
Like this, so then when you punch that thing in, there's little gaps that I did fill with some sealant, put some sealant underneath that collar so that the grease now goes here instead of squirting out there.
Yeah, nice.
So, perfect.
Right on. Throw it together and...
Yeah, throw it together and then we gotta change the ones in here.
Yeah. Okay, everything's back in. The bar is just a touch low. So jack it back up again. You think we're low?
Another quarter inch.
Right, oh, hold on.
If your floor is level.
Is your floor level?
We can level it.
And really, we're just lining up this bottom one. We can slide the top bar into that pin afterwards.
It's just top a bit, you think?
Not much more. Well, probably a little bit, but let's get it closer. And then,
yeah, right. What are the chances of it going side to side?
That's what I was worried about, but that's why we have these high dollar wheel chocks here.
Oh, okay.
Brought from Bedrock over there. You got yours kicked out?
Yep. Not yet.
Fred Flintstone's wheel chocks. He's from a little bit more modern era.
I could have brought mine. This is a guy that owns like dozens and dozens of properties, but won't put a car.
Dozens and dozens.
Dozens of properties around the area.
Yeah,
whatever. Massive landlord. Owns half a dozen, won't buy a wheel chock.
Don't believe everything you hear on the internet.
That's hefty.
Oh, my brush is broken.
That's a pain. You're gonna get it all inside the cab.
Yeah, we're gonna get, no, you're gonna do this.
I'm gonna drive?
No, you're gonna do the never seizing.
Am I? I'm holding the camera. I don't have any free hands.
Well, your camera needs to be gray too.
Yeah. Aaron won't touch anything in my shop because he's like, get all my stuff dirty. That's what he says anyway.
Man, just a cop out. Because we need to be able to get this pin out again when we do this job the next time.
Yeah, 20 years from now?
Yeah, a kid can do it.
When we're making our own fuel because they've outlawed everything.
When we're living on Mars.
Yeah. It's no fuel. I got ether. You might have to take the bar and stick it. Take a look.
It's close.
It's so close. Are you greasing the top pin, but you never seize the middle pin?
Well, because the middle pin and the back one are going through a
Teflon
greasable bearing.
Yeah, Teflon.
So those pins aren't going to move, right?
No.
And they're going to seize up. Where this one is actually going to wear against this bushing, right?
Okay.
And it has a grease fitting on it, so that means it must get grease.
Genius. All right, so we got the pin down, but not all the way because we got to put the roll bar in underneath. And then, so we're putting the top drawbar in, which will help kind of support the tractor a little better because we need to take that bottom jack out to get the drawbar in. I'll watch.
Okay, now I gotta go up. Hold on.
Well, I got a special tool for that.
I got it.
It's just right here. Watch.
Oh.
Is this?
Where'd you get that, Prince's Auto?
I'm thinking it came from this neighbor down the road, maybe.
Don't go looking for your driver's license.
Is it mine?
No.
Okay, ready?
Yeah, you're a touch high, but yeah, there you go. You got her. Okay, wait. Hold on. No, wait. One sec.
And that little washer.
Yeah, there you go. Okay, maybe an inch.
Okay, oh. Now don't do anything. I'm gonna stick my finger in there.
I gotta go like an inch in
over here. You're pretty close here.
It started.
Big sludge and it would drop right in.
We gotta jack it up a lot.
Both of them?
Because the back's gonna.
Oh, yeah.
It's gotta go like this.
Yeah, I see that. Yeah, right. You're right.
Considering there's no weight on that.
Well, you should be able to tell from the hole at the back.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Right?
Yep. Yeah. Well, you go back there, I'll keep pumping.
Whoop. Looks good here.
Sledge, one big hit, and it'll drop right in. Oh, yeah.
I like to push that in with the finger.
She's a beaut.
That's how it's supposed to go. And then now pin them back. Rich, you're supposed to put grease up on it.
I'm holding the camera. I can't get the camera dirty.
Yeah. So when your kids are watching this video on how to do it,
like, oh, he put an Everseize on it. Awesome. Way to go, Dad.
You just pump this jack up just a touch more.
You just don't get the satisfaction of.
Yeah? Just keep pumping until you keep hitting and I'll keep pumping.
Well. You found the right spot.
Nice.
Line the bolt holes up because once we take the jacks off, we won't be able to.
You won't be able to turn that.
Turn the thing anymore. I don't know, I gotta.
Okay, so we started by putting the bottom pin in and you can, we had to go back and forth with the wheels just to get to line up perfectly straight that way. Put the pin in, but not all the way, just into the bottom of the C. Then put the top pin in, front and back. You can play with that with the jack forward and back. Now we can get rid of this jack here and put the drawbar in, which goes in and connects to that pin. Drop the pin in, and that's it. To have that top nut on before you start beating it with a sledgehammer.
You will have a rotten time to start that, and they don't really give you enough threads to cut off like six threads and catch the nut on the bottom, but that's it, she's in.
You might have to clean those threads off of here. No?
It starts.
Yeah, I see one peeled over there, but yeah. Just clean those bottom two threads up. That's not bad.
No, that's pretty good. I'm happy with that.
So yeah, and then torque those to 1,500 foot-pounds.
1,200.
You gotta get a torque multiplier
for that. Yeah, and then you'll be able to. So if you torque it to 1,200 and then take the nut off again and put that extra washer on there.
Yeah, once it's torqued.
Nice. Okay, we do have to do the bushings on the steering.
It's gonna be just fine here. We can zip that off for a minute.
Kevin wants to keep going, I don't. So if you can do the center pins down the pivot pins, then I'm sure you can handle the steering pins. Right, Kevin?
Oh, I don't know, steering pins is pretty technical.
Yeah. So, yeah, clean up those threads, put it together,
And if we can do it on a dirt floor that's completely uneven, you guys can handle this on a nice concrete
one
floor.
Guy, Facebook's got his spread apart in his dirt floor.
Yeah. It,
oh. That sucks.
Vince!
Imagine how little joy you would have if that was electric and you did all that work and it just kind of hummed out of the shop and rolled out the driveway. It can't compare to just the first, you know, sun shining, springs going, firing it up, smoke coming out, all this noise. Like,
well, it's in its second home right now.
Yeah, I know.
Beside the fuel tank.
that is the downside to it. But. Very nice. So can you feel the difference?
Nice well, normally when you hit the clutch, it would go clunk, right? It doesn't go clunk anymore.
Nice.
I turned it sharp and still have a window, so. The glass guy from, I don't know his number. He's just the glass guy. He's an older guy. He's been cutting laminate for like 30 years.
So he cut the corners and everything?
Yeah, he cut the corners. He says, corners is no problem. I says, well, how'd you do that? He says, well, you just cut it. Okay.
Nice.
All right, and then he sands it all down, and then originally they had like a bead of silicone in here.
Yeah.
Right. He put the urethane in.
Yeah.
Because he said, oh, I guess it's bad luck with silicone. He says eventually it'll just all be leaking and you'll be mad. So he says now good luck if you break them trying to get that apart now.
Nice. So it was $300 a glass from
$330
from Case.
From Case for just the glass. Now there was something online, but that website was under construction, so I don't know if you can buy them. You must be able to buy them aftermarket somewhere. But he cut those and installed them for $400 for both of them. So
nice.
That was a good deal.
$600 savings. Right on. So that's it.
We're done.
That's this season.
That's it. The sun's shining. It's warm. We're gonna hook around to something and go drag it around the field.
Nice. Awesome. All right. All right. Sorry for the lack or big space in between videos, but. Nothing's forgotten, it's just we're focusing on Motorama and the F-350, and I do have a couple more coming on heavy duty, and we also did manage to find a low boy that we will be doing a complete restoration on, so that's coming up too. Thanks for watching. Remember, if you're not filthy, you're not Rich or Kevin, and yeah, get out there and work on it. Here we go.